We're supposed to start with a story, right? So here's my story. Perhaps you've heard about Bill Miller. Bill was a farmer,
hard, and had all of the character qualities of that you associate with the hard-working rural folk of the Midwest. Very impressive guy, raised four kids, loved his wife. And one day, Bill was out plowing the field, and this hard-working man of character had a heart attack and bought the farm. Well, as the story goes, he went up to the pearly gates, and as he approached these marble doors that were gold inlaid, there was a sign over the archway that said 1,000 points. So St. Peter came out to greet him and said, "Hi, Bill, great to have you here. Tell me what you've done, how you qualify to enter the kingdom of heaven." So Bill said, "Well, I have had a committed relationship with my wife. I've loved her selflessly for 50 years. We've had a tremendous marriage." Peter was very impressed, and he looked at Bill and said, "That'll be 1 point." So Bill thought, Peter said, "What else?" So he thought, "Well, you know what? I've raised four great kids. They're all young men and women of character. They've been involved in their communities. And my wife and I have just been tremendously committed to them." Well, by now you could tell that Peter was really moved. And he said, 1 point. Now, Bill began to worry about this thing because he looked up at the deal here and realized he needed 1,000 and he's only got 2. So he thought, "Well, this will cinch it. Peter, I believe in God, and I have been committed to my church. I've given abundantly to my church, and I went not as a hypocrite, but sincerely, and I've done this all my life." Well, at this point, Peter, he just commented, "Bill, I don't know that I've ever seen someone come before this gateway that had the qualifications you have. That'll be 1 point." So Bill looks at the 1,000, looks at his 3, and he says, "Peter, I don't know what to say. It's only by the grace of God I'm going to get in here." Peter said, "That'll be 997 points." I'm right on it. The whole issue of entrance into the kingdom of heaven is going to be the discussion today. And what I'd like to suggest here, that there's an aspect of Bill's theology that is absolutely biblical to the core in the New Testament, but in a slightly different way than my review will indicate that some of these other writers are stating it. What is the issue before us? Throughout the Gospels, Jesus makes numerous statements that can be very problematic. For example, he says in Matthew 5:20, "Unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven." And interpreters have commonly looked at this and understand the thing to mean, well, it seems like you've got to have some kind of ethical lifestyle if you're going to enter the kingdom. Because the righteousness in the Gospel of Matthew is not the imputed righteousness of Christ. It's the ethical righteousness that Jesus delineates in the sermon itself. So if we're going to take it in a straightforward way, Jesus does seem to be saying that if you're going to get into heaven or the kingdom, you've got to live out the Sermon on the Mount. Looks like works. Or you go to Matthew 7:21. Jesus says, only those who do the will of the Father will be admitted into the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone who says to me, "Lord, Lord," will get into the heaven kingdom. Only those who do the will of the Father. Now, I'm aware that there's a very plausible explanation of that. It could mean that the will of the Father is to believe upon him whom he has sent. In fact, that's what I said in my book, but I've changed my views. I think that's permissible. I learned that yesterday. The will of the Father is to live out the Sermon on the Mount. That's the context of this thing. So it appears that we have another passage that's teaching that salvation is by works. Now, there's about 9 specific instances in the Gospels where works are associated with entering the kingdom. So that's the issue. How do we address this? Now, the essence of the argument of the writers that I'm going to comment on goes something like this. The major premise is that terms such as eternal life, saved, inheritance, or the phrase enter the kingdom all refer to personal salvation from sin. Minor premise is all these terms have conditions of works attached to them in many passages of the New Testament. The conclusion, then, is that works are necessary for personal salvation. Now, that's the essence of the argument that we're going to address here. Now, there's been 4 approaches to this problem of the apparent need for works in the Gospels as a requirement for entering the kingdom. The Arminian says faith alone saves, but faith plus God-produced works keeps one saved. Somewhat similar to the so-called new perspective on Paul that N.T. Wright and E.P. Sanders and others have been advocating. The experimental predestinarian, that's my term for the reform, faith alone saves, and the faith that saves is not alone. In other words, genuine faith will always produce a life of works. So, for example, when Jesus says, unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes or the Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom, what Jesus is really saying, he's not presenting a condition of entrance, but a description of the character of the saved. Very common interpretation of this, for which I can see no basis or hint in the text. The partakers, the viewpoint that I've called the partakers, based on Hebrews 3:14, we are partakers or partners of Christ if we hold fast our assurance firm to the end. The thought here is that faith alone saves at the beginning and at the end, but choices made by the believer and enabled by God result in rewards. In the final category, I'm calling the neo-nomian. And I don't mean this in a pejorative way, a neo meaning new, nomian law. These are the new legalists, and I don't mean that in a negative sense. I'm just trying to come up with some kind of label to generally describe this viewpoint. And essentially, it's the view that says faith alone saves at the beginning, but faith plus God-produced works saves at the end. In other words, in the final analysis, works are involved in our obtaining final entrance into heaven. Now, there's several distinctives that I want to highlight before I analyze in more detail what they believe and our response. First, in regard to works for salvation, it's very clever. They draw a distinction between pre-conversion works, which don't save, and post-conversion works, which do. You may be wondering how someone can believe that salvation is by works when Paul says, by grace you are saved through faith apart from works, lest any man should boast. Aha! That refers to pre-conversion works for the non-believer. That person cannot be saved by works, but the believer can. And the post-conversion works of the saved man ultimately are necessary for him to obtain entrance into eternal life. When they talk about works being an evidence of salvation, it seems to me there's a little bit of double talk here. On one hand, if you're looking back, your works are supposed to be viewed as a demonstration, the classical Reformed view. True faith demonstrates itself in a life of works. But looking forward, works are to be viewed as a condition. So on the one hand, the believer is supposed to look at his works as a demonstration of a salvation already obtained. But on the other hand, he's supposed to view his works as a condition necessary for to obtaining salvation. So there's a little bit of confusion here. The believer has to hold two opposite points of view in mind at the same time. In regard to justification, they would say that initial justification, the declaration that we're right with God, is by faith alone apart from works. They're very emphatic about this. But final justification is by God-produced works. Salvation itself, it's not an event, it's a process. Alan Stanley in his book will call it a pilgrimage. Don't have that in the book up here, but Thomas Schreiner calls it we should view salvation holistically. And the problem with many evangelicals is they have tended to view it as an event instead of a process occurring over a lifetime. Hence, when we're saved by faith alone, yes, faith persisting over a lifetime and producing works, because salvation is a process extending over the life. So it has to be viewed holistically. Rewards. Rewards are obtained by God-produced works, but they refer to obtaining heaven. You go through all of the passages that most of us would associate with the judgment seat of Christ. They would relate them all to the great white throne judgment and refer to the admission or rejection that Jesus prescribes regarding one's eternal destiny. So those are four basic commonalities of what I'm calling the neo-nomian view. Now, who are these guys? Well, okay, a word about assurance. Assurance is based on the promises of God, evidence in the life, but it's postponed to the final hour because salvation is a process, and it's only persistent faith and endurance that saves, and one, unfortunately, cannot know if he will persist until he has. So this logically results in no reliable certainty that I'm saved now. Well, who are these gentlemen? Robert Sugenis wrote a book called Not by Faith Alone. Sugenis is president of the Catholic Apologetics International. He was born Catholic, later became Reformed, went to Westminster Seminary, and then rejected the Reformed faith and came back to Catholicism. And he defends a viewpoint that's very similar to what these evangelical writers are saying in his book. A book that many of you have probably heard of is written by Thomas Schreiner and Ardell Kennedy, The Race Set Before Us. These two men are professors. In fact, Schreiner is a professor at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky. He's written an excellent commentary on the book of Romans. Well, it's excellent, but probably a lot of us would have some questions about some of his interpretations, but nevertheless, it's a good commentary. And he's written a very good book. It's very well researched, very good spirit. Paul Rainbow, The Way of Salvation in Christian Obedience. Paul has lectured at North American Baptist Seminary in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, since 1988. He's an evangelical, but he's also a member of the Catholic Biblical Association. You can see that a lot of these writers are embracing at least some aspects of the of Roman theology. This one is one of the most radical, Chris Van Landingham, Judgment and Justification in Early Judaism and the Apostle Paul. Van Landingham is the assistant professor of ancient history, or was, at Oral Roberts University, solid evangelical at one point. And he is currently an adjunct professor at St. Gregory's University. They're both in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Somewhere along the line, you may hear this described as the federal vision. This is a movement within the Reformed Church to revise or update or modernize covenant theology. Hence, it's a new vision for federal theology. They deny standard of the Reformed faith, which is a limited atonement. Auburn Avenue theology, you might hear it by this name, because a series of seminal meetings were held there. And then Shepherdism is one of the most prominent writers on this particular viewpoint. But the person we're going to talk about this morning is Alan Stanley. He's recently published a book, Did Jesus Teach Salvation by Works? The Role of Works in Salvation in the Synoptic Gospels. Alan is a PhD graduate from Dallas Seminary. I think it was 2002. This book is a result, or it really is his PhD dissertation. It was published by as an Evangelical Theological Society monograph. It is very well researched. One thing you cannot accuse him of is not covering his bases. One of his interlocutors is the Free Grace Movement, and on a number of occasions he is interacting with the viewpoints of Zane Hodges and Bob Wilkin and a few others, myself included. For the most part, he's done a good job of understanding what the free grace viewpoint is about. He's very gracious. He writes it in a Rennick manner. And if you want a good book that summarizes this viewpoint, this is one of the best that I've found. But he does conclude that Jesus teaches salvation by works. Very surprising that an evangelical scholar, particularly from that institution, would do that. His book raises five key questions that we're going to drill down on this morning. The first is, what does it mean to enter the kingdom? We've already alluded to the fact that it seems to be predicated or conditioned upon works in the nine instances that the phrase is used in the New Testament. The second issue is endurance required? Stanley says yes, and he goes to Matthew 10. He who endures to the end will be saved. And he understands salvation there as personal salvation from sin. Well, are the works of the believer meritorious? Stanley, in the tradition of Westminster Calvinism, says absolutely not. As we'll discuss this in a moment, I strongly disagree with him. Works of the believer are meritorious for rewards, but not for salvation. Is justification instantaneous and complete? This is a critical question, because if it is, Stanley's whole thesis and the neo-nomian thesis is nullified. So we want to look very precisely at that. Stanley would say, well, yeah, initial justification is, but final justification is not, and you get lost in a sea of ambiguity trying to get your head around these distinctions. And then, can a believer have assurance of salvation? Although Stanley has extensive discussions in his book of salvation, the bottom line is, he admits, salvation is postponed to the final hour, because no one can be sure until the final hour that he has in fact produced enough works to qualify him for entrance into the kingdom. Okay, let's pick up these questions briefly. First question is, what does it mean to enter the kingdom? Jesus says, "For I say to you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven." I think for evangelicals to lean on the fact that the surpassing righteousness is the imputed righteousness of Christ is to lean on a broken reed. The context to me is clearly defining this righteousness in terms of the six antitheses which follow. You have heard it said, but I say unto you, etc. And the righteousness, in fact, in Matthew throughout is ethical, it's behavior, it's lifestyle. So it does seem to me that if we're going to be fair to the text, we've got to acknowledge that the Neonomians are absolutely correct here, that a surpassing ethical lifestyle is a condition of entering the kingdom. But there's another verse. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter. See, future tense again. But he who does the will of my Father. Now again, I understand that could refer to believing in Christ. That could be the will of Father, going to the passage in John. However, in the context of Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, the will of the Father, it seems to me, is clearly an ethical lifestyle. It's living out the principles of the sermon. But also in Matthew, there are references to entering the kingdom in the present. This is the parable of the two sons. One of them repented, changed his mind. I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe, defining repentance here in terms of they changed their mind and are now believing, but the tax collectors and prostitutes did. So here is an entrance to the kingdom that is unrelated to works. It's related to one thing, believing, in the present tense. Now, Stanley makes the statement that somewhere along the way, converted sinners become righteous and therefore eligible to enter the kingdom. When you read that statement in his book, you kind of recoil. You say, my goodness, how can I ever know I'm going to go to heaven? Because how do I ever know that I'm righteous enough to enter? In verse 19 of Matthew 5, Jesus makes an astonishing statement. Anyone who breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom. Now let's look at what this is saying. I remember the other day I was talking with a gentleman from the Reformed faith, and he was pressing me very hard. And he said, look, show me one verse where it says that carnal Christians can go to heaven. So I took him to this verse. Here's some people who break the least of these commandments. In other words, they're lawless, they're lawbreakers, but furthermore, they're false prophets. They teach others to do the same. In other words, they tell other people things that God did not say. And yet these people are in the kingdom. The question, though, is their status. And they're going to be called least. They'll be there, but they will be least in this kingdom. In contrast, whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom. Now, this seems to create a contradiction because verse 19 says that these false prophets and lawless ones will be in the kingdom, but verse 20 says, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom. So here are some people in verse 19 who are in the kingdom, and yet according to verse 20, they don't have the righteousness necessary to enter it. Now it's surprising that the commentators don't deal a lot with this problem. Paradoxically, this man who is stated to be in the kingdom in verse 19 does not, according to Matthew 20, possess the righteousness necessary to enter it. Now, there's several solutions to this conundrum that have been in the literature. Chrysostom and Augustine said, least means, well, he's just a professing Christian. And, of course, that's just an obvious evasion because it says he's in the kingdom. Another angle is that they kept the law for the most part. they were false prophets and they disobeyed the law, and it really doesn't help you much. The Neonomian says, well, this is salvation by post-conversion works is the solution. In other words, there's an initial entrance by faith alone. They would go to a passage like John 3. But there's a final entrance by works. The completion of this process, the completion of this pilgrimage is achieved by perseverance in good works. So this is a verse for them proving that final entrance into heaven is based upon good works. Now the partaker, the label I have hung on my particular viewpoint and that of the free grace view, although I'm not ascribing this to the free grace now, this is somewhat novel. But what I'm suggesting is that what is in view here in entering the kingdom in this passage is greatness and reward by post-conversion works. So a definition of enter the kingdom is to enter into the kingdom way of living now, the Sermon on the Mount, resulting in greatness when one enters the kingdom in the future. How to become great? Notice in verse 19, whoever practices and teaches, but in verse 20, for I tell you. We know from that he's specifically addressing the regenerate, born-again disciples. In fact, the whole sermon is addressed to them, according to chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. So now he's coming to his disciples, and he's telling them that unless they have righteousness necessary of the Sermon on the Mount, they will not enter. Notice the connection here with the word for. It seems to me that a plausible solution to this conundrum is to simply say that verse 20 is an expansion and explanation of how to be great at the end of verse 19. In other words, when Jesus said, you can be called great, the next question would be, well, how? And of course, this was a question that we know from other passages in the New Testament that the disciples were commonly involved in. They even had a helicopter mom that went to Jesus and, you know, hover, that wanted to get their sons a high place in the kingdom. So what he's doing is he's expanding on the word great. And what I'm suggesting here is if they're already in the kingdom but don't have the righteousness necessary to enter it, enter the kingdom must be used in two different senses. There's an initial entrance by faith alone, resulting in regeneration. We looked at one passage, Matthew 21, but also our common passage in John. But then there's a final entrance achieved by living out the Sermon on the Mount now, resulting in greatness and reward in the future kingdom. Is endurance necessary for salvation? Alan Stanley says yes. And he goes to a passage like this. This is in Matthew chapter 10. The Lord Jesus has just sent his disciples out on a mission, and he's preparing them for conflict and persecution. Verse 21, and brother will deliver up brother, and a father his child, and children will rise up against their parents and cause them to be put to death, and you will be hated by all on my account, or on account of my name. But it is the one who has endured to the end that will be saved. Now you see that same passage in Matthew 24. Now, Stanley's view on this is stated this way. Looking at these things from a purely exegetical standpoint, it is difficult to escape the fact that these passages do teach that endurance is a condition to final salvation. Now, this raises some questions. What does it mean to be saved? Saved from what or to what? What does it mean to endure? And what is the end? Now, Briefly, the answer to the third one, in my view, is I know that there's a view that it says it means the end of the tribulation or something. I think it just means as long as it takes. The one who endures for as long as it takes, however long it takes. But what I want to focus on is the first question. What does it mean to be saved? Verse 28. And do not fear those who kill the body, but are unable to kill the soul. But rather, fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Well, Stanley and the Neonomians go to this as proof that the subject matter here is eternal damnation. And you can understand where they would get that. On the other hand, if you look at this more carefully, it's quite plausible that what Jesus is saying here is that we're not to fear going to hell, but we're to fear him. In other words, it's a healthy fear. It's the fear of the Lord discussed in the Old Testament. Because he comes back and he says, verse 31, therefore, do not fear. You're of more value than sparrows. So, it's quite possible that his meaning is simply, look, don't worry about or don't fear the apostles. Or excuse me, don't fear the, got that one backward, don't fear the persecutors. Rather, I want you to live in a healthy fear of me, as described in the Old Testament. And I want you to be comforted in that fear, because you're of much more value to me than sparrows. So take comfort in that. So it's not necessary to understand that phrase as Jesus threatening the apostles with eternal damnation, as the Neonomians do. But then it gets a little stickier. But whoever shall deny me before men, I will deny him before my Father in heaven. Well, see, the Neonomians say, this is obviously referring to post-mortem condemnation to hell. Here's a believer who's going to stand before the great white throne judgment, and he's going to be denied entrance. Now, the premise upon which that is built, of course, is that the word deny means rejection from heaven. Is it possible that it could mean something else? In the parallel passage in Mark, for example, Mark doesn't use the word deny, he uses the word ashamed. Whoever is ashamed of me in this sinful generation, I will be ashamed of him. Well, that's a little softer than deny. Is it possible in the New Testament that the believer standing before the judgment seat of Christ or could experience a sense of shame? Is this a thought found in other passages in the New Testament? Yes, it is. 1 John 2:28, he speaks of the fact that one day we might we're to live a life of love, otherwise we might draw back in shame before him at his coming. I'm reminded of the passage in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, where God says, if believers live out this ethical lifestyle of faith, he will not be ashamed to call them, to be called their God. And how about 1 Corinthians 9, where Paul says that he is pressing on, it's an athletic metaphor, straining every nerve so that he won't be disqualified, a dokimos, which is disqualified in the athletic contest. So there is New Testament data to suggest that a denial, it could be something in terms of being ashamed or being found disqualified for the prize. There's no need to jump immediately to the notion, as Stanley does, that to be denied by Christ refers to post-mortem consignment to damnation. But the real question is, what is the meaning of salvation? Stanley and the Neonomians in general assume all through their book that salvation is a future salvation. They do acknowledge a present tense or a past tense salvation, but they place a lot of the focus that it's a future salvation from personal sin. However, in verse 39, Jesus says, "He who has found his life shall lose it, and he who has lost his life for my sake shall find it." Now, this is commonly understood, not universally, but very commonly understood by many scholars to refer to finding true life now by living as a disciple, and not finding life in the sense of finding heaven when one dies. If that is so, and I believe it is, we don't have time to get into all this right now. Salvation in this passage is from a meaningless and empty and spiritually impoverished life. To lose one's life refers to this temporal destitution of a carnal Christian experience. But a person who sacrifices himself, puts others first, and lives out the life of a disciple can find true life. Well, the Neo-Nomians say yes, but all the passages in the New Testament about rewards are equal to eternal life. And this is a passage about rewards. Verse 41, "He who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward." So he's promising to his apostles a prophet's reward. "And he who receives a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward." The Greek word is misthos, and it means a payment for work done. We're going to come back to this in a moment. The idea that this would be related to salvation from sin is so far removed from the free grace offer in the New Testament that it's almost incomprehensible to me that these guys can look at these verses that use the word reward, which means remuneration for work done, and apply that to obtaining one's eternal destiny. So this passage about enduring to the end in order to be saved speaks of victorious perseverance in the face of persecution by living in fear of the Lord, resulting in salvation from an empty and meaningless life and to a full experience of life, reward, and greatness in the coming kingdom. Well, what about the works of the believer being meritorious? Oh, one thing. Let me just. Let's think about what Stanley says for a moment. This is addressed to his apostles, regenerate, born again men. And on Stanley's thesis, these men that he spent 4 years with, whom he loves, he's invested his life in, and who he says are of great value, he's sending them out into persecution, and he's saying, "If you men fail, I'm going to send you to hell." Now, can anyone seriously believe that this is the thrust of this passage? And yet that's what the Neo-Nomians tell us. They don't put it as crassly as I just did, but that's the inference of their viewpoint. Well, what about these works? Since salvation, according to the Neo-Nomians, future salvation is based on works, they spend a lot of time attempting to prove that no merit is involved. Because if merit was involved, then they know they would be in trouble with the biblical doctrine of salvation apart from the merit of human works. However, the words used for the works of the believer, such as misthos, 1 Corinthians 3:14, "If any man's work which he has built upon it remains, he'll receive a reward," means remuneration for work done. Or antipodesis in Colossians 3:24, "that which is given to someone in exchange for what has been done," is what that means. Very difficult to understand that as something related to personal salvation from sin. Or mistha paideia, Hebrews 10:35, payment of wages is how this is translated in the lexicons. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has great reward. Or komizo, that's our word in the judgment seat of Christ passage. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed. And the word means to get back something that is one's own or is owed to one. Now, how a person can describe the works of the Christian man in these terms and relate them to some kind of entry into heaven and say it's non-meritorious is beyond me. But they also camp on the fact that these works are produced 100% by God. And since they're all God's works, the believer is supposedly excused from salvation by works because it's God's works in the believer. Yet in the New Testament, we see a cooperation with God in the production of works. God's role is to enable, to motivate, to command. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But it is God's work within us to enable us, to motivate us, to inspire us, to strengthen us to do it. But also, these works are not perfect, yet God requires perfection. And if God was doing this 100% of God, then the works would be perfect and we would in fact qualify. Problem is, none of us have perfect. So how does Stanley handle this? He says, well, one of the problems that people from our viewpoint have is that they make the conditions of discipleship, his word is, overly arduous. So what he does is he waters down the standard because he realizes that perfection is required, so perfection can't be required. So what you water down is the standard. Is justification instantaneous and complete? Clearly, Jesus knows of a justification that will take place in the day of judgment. This is Stanley again. And it is likely that James is speaking of the same judgment, where James in 2:24 says we're justified by works. That is, all people will be judged on the basis of their works vis-a-vis their eternal destiny. Now, this problem, of course, has been discussed for centuries. It was at the core of a lot of the debates during the Reformation. Paul says we're justified by faith apart from works. James says we're justified by works. Now, Stanley knows that historically there have been solutions to this that don't require that future justification is personal removal of sin and entrance into heaven. Justification in James, as very commonly interpreted, refers to justification before men or a kind of vindication of a life well lived. And without getting into all the details, let me just mention that that is a very common interpretation, and he knows that. And it does not require a salvation by works, such as Stanley suggests. The Bible is clear. But when this priest had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. Since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool, because by one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. The faith of Abraham. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him for righteousness. You see, the law required two things. It required a perfect life. But it also required a penalty for failure to obtain that perfect life. And the mediator had to solve both problems. So when the Lord Jesus Christ died on that cross, he not only paid the penalty for our sin and hence substituted for us, but because of his perfect life, his righteousness, he obeyed on our behalf. And in the doctrine of justification, his obedience is reckoned to our account. So if that is true, and the Neo-Nomians deny it, they have to, because it nullifies their whole thesis. If I have already been reckoned righteousness due to the impartation or the imputation of the righteousness of Christ, then I do not have to obey or perform any good works to ultimately obtain eternal life. Jesus has already obeyed on my behalf. Therefore, since we have been justified, declared righteous, we have peace. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. If his obedience has already been credited to my account, I do not have to do any good works in order to obtain eternal life. But by his doing, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God and righteousness. Shed put it this way: this part of Christ's agency is necessary because merely to atone for past transgression would not be a complete salvation. It would indeed save man from hell, but it would not introduce him to heaven. The mediator, therefore, must not only suffer for man, but he must also obey for him. You know, on our deathbed, the last thing that we are going to think about is the God-produced works in our life. The only claim that's going to be going through my mind at the final hour is that I have received the righteousness of Christ, and not that I have cooperated with God in producing a certain degree of works in my life and therefore have become eligible, to use Stanley's term. I need to wrap it up at this point and throw it open for questions, but I want to just close with an obvious point about assurance. On Stanley's premise, assurance is impossible. We've already alluded to this, because one cannot know that he will persevere until, in fact, he has persevered. Recall his statement: one becomes righteous and therefore eligible to enter. Another place he says, if salvation is something that is yet to be completed, and he thinks it is, then to speak of losing one's salvation is technically a contradiction in terms, for one cannot lose what they have not yet attained. Now, time out. Forget the theology and the exegesis for a minute. Does anybody want to live their life this way? If that was the gospel that was offered to me as a college student, that I could be initially saved by faith, but then pursue a life of works in order to complete it and obtain it in a heaven, I would have rejected it. The last thing I need when I'm discouraged and in failure is to worry about my eternal destiny. Maybe I'm not his child. And yet that's the logical place that this theology of Neo-Nomianism takes us. Okay, let's take some time for questions. What I'd like to do is not write them down, because I can't read them. I just like to do it orally. The reason they write them down is because people get up and they want to make a speech. And Bob said, we don't want that. We want you to just state the question succinctly so that other people have an opportunity. So I'll just do it orally, raise your hand, and then we'll interact. Yeah.
Can you re-clarify, please, the two senses of entering the kingdom?
Yeah, two senses of entering the kingdom. I'm suggesting that initial entrance is by faith alone and results in regeneration. But when Jesus talks about a future entrance, a final entrance, and relates it to works, that he's talking about status, greatness. It's verse 20 of Matthew 5 is an explanation of how to become great in verse 19.
Yeah. How is that like not entering twice then? Isn't that kind of like a special meaning in a sense? Would initial entrance be through positional, experiential, or both?
Both. The final entrance is it's not special pleading, at least the way I'm arguing it, because you've got a guy in verse 19 of Matthew 5 who's in the kingdom, But according to verse 20, he doesn't have the righteousness necessary to enter it. Ergo, since he's already entered, in one sense, the one in verse 20 must mean a different sense. And how do I justify that? Well, I say, well, Jesus says, for, unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness. So he's pointing back to verse 19, and he's expanding on how to become great. Make sense? Obviously not.
Go ahead.
Why does that still seem like he's entering twice, though?
Well, yeah, the meaning changes. Just like there's two senses of justification. There's a vindication before men, and there's a declaration of imputed righteousness. There's two senses of inheritance. There's a salvation. There's an inheritance that comes to us by faith alone, apart from works, but there's an inheritance that is a reward, Colossians 3:24. There's two senses of eternal life. There's eternal life in the sense of obtaining heaven and regeneration, but eternal life also in the sense of an abundant experience of life. And I'm just saying that there's two senses of the word enter as well. But the final entrance, the person goes into the kingdom geographically, spatially, but he doesn't rule there. In fact, one way to translate, you know, like in Matthew 25, where it says, he looks to the sheep and he says, inherit a kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. It's probably best to render that, inherit a kingship. It's an arthros in Greek. It's a city, 5 or 10, that have been prepared for this faithful believer from the foundation of the world. So that final entrance, that final inheritance, is a kingship. It's co-rulership with Jesus in the final destiny of man.
I got it with my wife. <That's bad. laughs>
Good point. I thought I commented on this. I do not in any way want to suggest that Alan is not a believer. In fact, I'm in correspondence with him right now. My best take on it, he's a fine guy, loves the Lord, and we're exchanging emails right now. So as I've talked with him, I've sensed that he really has a sincere heart, and he's not hostile or anything like that. And his book has a lot of commendable qualities. He's clear on a lot of issues that we would agree upon, but...
Jody, in Matthew 6, the one who's able to send you to hell, basically, and parallel passage, can we see hell as a broader category, including the fire of purification, in which one's worthless works and inheritance will be burned and destroyed? For instance, Revelation 21, 7 and 8, the meros, the portion, is in the lake of fire, and that would be parallel to 1 Corinthians 3, 14, 15, that you mentioned.
Yeah, I think personally, in fact, I've written, I'm going to publish a journal article on this, that in some places in the New Testament, Gehenna is a reference to shame and disgrace at the judgment seat of Christ. Like in Matthew 25, it's the Gehenna of fire, the eternal damnation, the lake of fire. But it is possible in other places that the reference is not to hell. Now, this does nothing with the, at least in my opinion, now that's very controversial, although there's a lot of guys that hold it, such as Michael Eaton, R.T. Kendall, A.B. Bruce, Adam Clark, N.T. Wright, a few others. So it's not totally novel, but at any rate, it is possible. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
In my view, all believers will be present on earth during the 1,000 years.
And some will not.
Some will not, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Is the abundant entrance of 2 Peter 1 in what you've been talking
about? Absolutely. That's what I would go to. The abundant entrance in 2 Peter 1 is this final entrance into greatness and status in the coming kingdom. Yeah.
You said in the Sermon on the Mount that Jesus is addressing regenerate believers.
Right.
Could you go into when people were regenerated, when that first started? I mean,
it says in chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, that his disciples came up and apparently surrounded him, and he said to them. So I'm saying, okay, that's what it says. So now, there may have been unregenerate people, hangers-on, listening, but the intent of the sermon appears to be addressed to the disciples. In fact, R.T. France, in his commentary on Matthew, which, by the way, get it, it is the best commentary I've ever read on Matthew. It's excellent. It's new. He says, look, let's not call this the Sermon on the Mount. Let's call it the Discourse on Discipleship. And it's a manual on how he wants his regenerate disciples to live if they're going to obtain greatness in the future reign of David's greater son. R.T. France, Gospel of Matthew. Guy over where?
Okay. How does why is the way of instruction narrow the way of life fit?
Question is, why does the way it leads to destruction narrow as the way that enters into life? How's that fit? That's commonly understood as a salvation passage because you've got destruction here, so that means go to hell, and narrow is the way that leads to life means go to heaven. However, in my own view, the word destruction there is never used that way by Matthew. The verb or the noun, it means ruin. And the life here is commonly understood in the New Testament not just as go to heaven when you die, but abundant life, rich life. And it is generally acknowledged that in the sermon, Jesus is adopting the stance of a wisdom teacher, echoing Proverbs, these pithy one-liners. And if you go back to the book of Proverbs and you look up life, just get out of concordance and do it, it's always about a rich life now as a result of living faithfully or wisely. So it seems to me that this is a call to the disciples. This is a discourse on discipleship. And the narrow way is the disciple has a choice in front of him. We might call it a lordship decision, Romans 12, 1 and 2. He can evaluate all this and say, you know, I'm going to go this way or this way. And he's exhorting them all through the sermon to go the narrow way, not the broad way. Because if they go the broad way, their lives will be ruined. They'll lose their lives and they'll forfeit their final significance. So he wants them to go the narrow way, which the Greek has a kind of a pretty, I don't know, picture of pressing. It's the way of difficulty and struggle. And if you choose that way and you persevere in it, you'll have life, true life now, and a great reward in the kingdom. Okay. I just got a sign that said stop. Okay.